You have a rather large portfolio of work related to the integration of infrastructure in cities. So for example, in Madrid or in Maastricht, we made proposals to put the highway in a tunnel and reclaim the deck of the tunnel as part of the city and the public domain of the citizens. In landscape architecture, the clients we work for are governments or city governments or sometimes developers who approach us for mainly two questions. The first question they approach us for is a question of placemaking. So they have a site which has, which lacks character, which lacks identity, and they invite us to develop a concept that adds character and identity to that place. The second question we get is more, let's say, problem driven. So cities or municipalities approach us with an environmental issue. So for example, they have a flooding issue. Many cities are built in estuary or along rivers or on coastlines. With climate change, they face a constant challenge to secure the safety of their citizens, while the banks of the river, for example, are too low. So there we, let's say basically the landscape architect is almost like an engineer. You have to resolve a technical environmental issue. And of course the challenge is that we make a solution for the problem, but in the solution we also create a new potential for the city, for example a new public space along the water. I think in general the aim of spatial design is to create value for the residents, a value not only in money but especially in the quality of life. That's, for example, what we do in Shanghai. In Shanghai, they have this problem where the level of the river is rising, and the areas, the city areas along the river, are endangered by flooding. And there, we create a new dikes and embankments along the river, but also, let's say, transform them into public spaces, linear parks along the river, that help the city to develop towards the river. So this new public space creates for the city an opportunity to redevelop the embankment of the river. To give you an example, we make a park in Hong Kong, in the cultural district of Hong Kong. And that's on the Victoria Harbour in Hong Kong. And it will be a cultural park, but the basis of the park is a green space. Hong Kong is in a climate zone, in a subtropical climate zone, where they have annual hurricane seasons. And so the site for the park is regularly blasted with heavy winds, but especially with heavy rains. So when we started to make a park there, a park design there, we drew a park in the Dutch condition. But then the engineers and our clients said, this won't work here. We need very large gullies to drain the water from the park. We need to, if you make a topography, we have to make stabilization to avoid erosion. At first, we found this a bit, exaggerated. But in reality, this is what happens. You have tremendous winds. So the first time we planted all the trees, there was a hurricane, and almost 50% of the trees they fell over. So they need a proper anchoring. So that is an example where we learned from the local conditions, constantly. Adapt our approach and constantly learn how to make landscapes and parks in different areas. I can give you an example. And the example is related to the to New York, to the Sandy hurricane that hit New York in 2014. And I can sketch it. So this is Manhattan in New York. Here is this is Brooklyn. This is Staten Island. It's a bit more like this. And this basically is the estuary of the Hudson River. When Sandy hit the coast of America, there was a strong wind blasting inland and a surge of water that drove into the Hudson estuary. Flooding large areas of Brooklyn, of Staten Island, and of Manhattan. So you've seen the images at the news. The metro system of Manhattan was completely flooded. Large areas were affected. So the state of New York was in a state of emergency, and a new solution had to be found to secure the city. The immediate response was to build along the banks of the estuary dikes or high walls. The estimate of the flood barriers that we had to make was about 7 meters high flood barriers. So a dike of 7 meters or a flood wall of 7 meters. So many officers worked on the issue of how can we deal with this flooding problem. And our approach was not to design a 7 meter high dike, but to look at the base of the problem. And for us, the base of the problem is where the estuary meets the ocean, and where basically the surge of the waves come into the estuary. So we worked with a group of maritime engineers and started to investigate if we could make a barrier at this condition where the estuary meets the sea. So here along the coast is Long Island. And we tested with the maritime engineers the idea to develop a group of islands in the at the end of the estuary. So we tested this theoretically with a group of maritime engineers. They found out that the introduction of these islands for the coast of North America doesn't resolve the problem completely, but reduces this flood difference from 7 to 3 meters. So we win by the introduction of natural islands in front of the coast. We only have to make a barrier in the city of 3 meters high. And 3 meters high is, you know, is still a barrier, but you can design it in the coastline and as a park or a pathway that goes up slowly. So that was the introduction of the islands. We think, so at first the islands are they are a technical solution for a problem, but in the second line they create opportunities for the city, they create ecology, new nature, but also expansion for recreation and leisure and as an antidote for urbanism.